Welcome to our Thursday Bible discussion, Speaking Words of Life. Know your adversary.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hey, people of God, how y'all doing today? The purpose of our assignment today is to have a Bible discussion. And today we're going to study to know our adversary. Not to fear our adversary, but to know our adversary, to recognize him when we see his truth operating in anything, the world, people of God. After today's session, we will know the origin of our adversary, and our hope is that after our study, we will recognize the enemy and how he might be operating in our lives also. You know, the devil is very clever and deceptive. He is the very reason for you to stay on your knees, to meditate on God's word daily, and to keep yourself under the control of the Holy Spirit. Children of God, sin desires to have you, but you must master it. The enemy is sneaky and most deceptive with his lying, persuasive words. He has deceived my people from generation to generation with sin, separating them from me and their true destiny, with misleading lies and temptations designed to hinder us from fulfilling our divine purpose and destiny on this earth. The devil keeps us from experiencing the fullness of our blessing, and it holds us under God's judgment. It's designed by the enemy to distract and entrap. Sin entangles us to the wages of death, attaching itself to God's eternal wrath. Sin is from Satan, and our sins show Satan's control operating in our life. Demons are disobedient spirits, people of God, looking for a place to rest. They are spirits that are in rebellion to God's truth. But some of y'all still think the enemy is not real. Today in this Bible discussion, we want you to go back and look at the scriptures that we give you, and they will reveal to you the reality of the enemy and his purpose on the earth in our lives also. Some of y'all think that the devil ain't real. A lot of y'all act like he's not real. Well, we will discover both the origin and purpose of Satan. That's the only thing, people of God, that can explain all the never-before things happening in our world today, right now. In today's discussion, the Word of God will unfold spiritual insight into knowing your adversary. Amen.
You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. The satyrs, topaz and diamond, braille, oxen and jaspers, sapphires, turquoise and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherubim who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created, till iniquity was found in you. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupt your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I laid you before kings, they that might gaze on you. Ezekiel 28, 13 through 15, verse 17.
Some of the scriptures in this passage, it describes Satan. It is clear that at times Ezekiel described this king in terms that could not apply to a mere human, people of God. This king had been in the Garden of Eden, had been ordained and anointed as a mighty angelical guardian, and had access to the holy mountain of God, but was banished from there.
There is a possible allusion of Satan's fall from heaven in the book of Isaiah. As the prophet is describing God's judgment on the king of Babylon, he veers into language that seems too grandiose to refer to any mere human. How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn, you have been cast down to the earth. You who once laid low the nations, you said in your heart, I will ascend to the heavens. I will raise my throne above the stars of God.
This is found in Isaiah 14, 12 through 15. And the other verse was Ezekiel 28, 1 through 19. Now, in this study, I found two things that, you know, at first I was like, because I heard it said, they said Lucifer, a name meaning bearer of light. And some, while it isn't certain that this passage alludes to Satan's pride and subsequent fall from heaven, it definitely could. The enemy comes like an angel of the light, but not really a light. The enemy is a spirit that needs a body to operate, people of God.
Morningstar definitions are, why are both Jesus and Satan referred to as the morning star? The morning star as Lucifer's son of the morning, it is clear from the rest of the passage that Isaiah is referring to Satan's fall from heaven. Luke 10, verse 18, and he said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. So in this case, the morning star refers to Satan. In Revelation 22, 16, Jesus unmistakably identifies himself as the morning star. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star.
You see the difference there? Jesus is the bright morning star. Why are both Jesus and Satan described as the morning star? It is interesting to note that the concept of the morning star is not the only concept that is applied to both Jesus and Satan. In Revelations, Jesus is referred to as the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. But in 1 Peter 5 and 8b, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. The point is this, both Jesus and Satan might have this certain name, but and have certain similarities as lions, but Jesus is similar to a lion in that he is the King of Kings. He is the royal and majestic, the Lion of Judah. Satan is similar to a lion in that he seeks to devour other creatures. That is where the similarities between Jesus and Satan and lions end. However, the enemy is a duplicator, not a creator. He's an imposter, people of God. Jesus and Satan are like lions, but in very different ways.
The ideal of a bright morning star is a star that outshines all others, and Jesus is the one who is called bright. Satan was a morning star. Jesus says, God incarnated, the Lord of the universe, is the bright and morning star. Jesus is the most holy and powerful light in all the universe. So while both Jesus and Satan can be described as morning stars, in no sense is this equating Jesus and Satan. Satan is a creature being. The light only exists to the extent that God created it. Jesus is the light of the world. John 9:5. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Only Jesus' light is bright and self-existent. Satan may be a morning star, but he is only a poor imitation of the one true bright morning star, Jesus Christ, the light of the world.
The word also reveals to us that the devil was a cherubim. And not just a cherubim, but the head cherubim. And what is a cherubim? It's a group of angels. So he was the head of this. These scriptures prove in itself that the devil is real, people of God. And that's what we got to stop letting him hide behind people, places, and things. If you believe that God is real and you believe his word, then that should settle it, people of God.
Scripture says a lot about the enemy's character and actions, who he is and what he does. But what about his origins? Where did he come from? Who created the devil?
The story of the Bible opens with creation, with God declaring the universe into being. The first two chapters are a breathtaking sense of order and wholeness and flourishing. No matter the maker surveys everything, he crafted and pronounces it very good. Then suddenly a snake. But this isn't any ordinary snake, people. God, this is one who talks. In fact, it's quite jagged. Before we know it, this slivery creature has struck up a conversation with Eve, luring her and her silent husband and you and me into a revolt against God. As the story unfolds, it becomes clear that this ancient serpent is a scary manifestation of Satan himself. The enemy was not born, people of God, he was created. The Bible tells us that he created the enemy in the Word.
In Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 through 17, it reads, "For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things consist."
The Bible never explicitly tells us where Satan originated. He presumably came into existence sometime after the creation of God's perfect world. Prior to his appearance in Eden, despite these unknowns, however, there are at least five things we can say with certainty about Satan. One, God created him. The scriptures proclaim that all things were created by God and for God. It makes sense then that this comprehensive category, all things, include even the devil. After all, if God wasn't behind Satan's creation, then who was? Another powerful being? If so, then that being would, at least in one sphere of existence, be in charge. There would be a realm over which God wouldn't be in full control. There is no realm in this world where God is not in control, people of God. Remember that.
And number two, God created him good. As the source of all goodness, beauty, and truth, God creates only what consists with his nature, things that are themselves good, beautiful, and true. Every facet of creation, whether in heaven or on earth, was originally very good. As Paul implies, observes, everything created by God is good. His character is wholly pure. There isn't a shred of darkness or deception in him. And Satan was created as an angel to serve and honor this great God. Obviously, something went wrong.
We were created with a free will. Satan had a free will. All the angels have a free will. Some created angels rebelled against God. They chose to follow the enemy. On two occasions, it speaks of a time when angels turned on God and fell into wickedness. And God did not spare the angels when they had sinned, but sent them to hell, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. The angels who did not keep their positions of authority but abandoned their proper dwelling, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on that great day. According to scripture, there was once an angelic insurrection against heaven, people of God.
And number four, Satan has authority in the realm of demons. As the prince of demons, it seems likely that Satan launched and led this heavenly revolt. Satan then was the first sinner. Indeed, he's been sinning from the beginning. The devil's position as captain of the demonic force is unmistakable. Scripture refers to him as the evil one, the ruler of this world, the god of this age, and the prince of the power of the air. All throughout the Bible, we witness him spearheading attacks on God's people with power to blind and oppress. Fallen angels are not treated as evil by creation, but as followers of Satan in his mutiny. At one time, the most glorious and powerful angelic agent, Satan was filled with pride and plotted the attempted heaven coup.
Amen. Number five, Satan's evil came from within himself. No one was around to tempt and lure Satan into sin. His evil arose from himself. It came from within him. It's not surprising then that Jesus would call him the father of lies and a murderer from the beginning. Language hearkening back to the offset of history. I heard a story about the origin of Satan's fall, and it was like he had passed by some clear water and he noticed himself, and he found out that he was beautiful. I mean, gorgeous. The most beautiful thing God had created. And it puffed him up. He became puffed up in himself. And he said, I will become like the Most High God, and everyone will worship me.
Now, names of Satan are devil, Lucifer, fallen angel, serpent, great red dragon, evil one, father of lies, ruler of this world and god of this age, ruler of the kingdom of the air, the tempter, the accusers of brothers or brothers and sisters, the dragon, the serpent, Beelzebul, Bela or Belar.
Now let's take a look at what these names mean, people of God. Satan means adversary, enemy, or opposer. It is the name most often used of the devil in scripture. It reminds us the fact that Satan hates God and his people, and he works fervently to obstruct and destroy all things that have to do with God, including keeping people from coming to him through Christ. He is an opposer in every sense of the word.
And devil. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 26 through 27, the title devil means slanderer. It is the second most used name of Satan in scripture. Devil is an apt name for Satan, since slandering others is a major aspect of his character. In Genesis chapter 3, he slandered God to Eve by implying that God was keeping the best from her. He said if she ate of the tree, she would not die, but instead be like God. In Job chapter 1, he slandered Job to God by saying that Job only followed God because God blessed him. Satan likewise slanders God's and other motives to us, and will even slander us to ourselves, because he is a commander who provokes anger, division, discouragement, and depression through his slander.
Amen. The evil one. It means, it's the third of the most used names for Satan. It represents his nature. He has no mixed motives or works. They are evil to the core, nothing but evil. If it were not for God restraining Satan, limiting his works would even be more horrendous, people of God. Father of lies. Christ said this about Satan. Whenever he lies, he speaks according to his own nature because he is a liar and the father of lies. Satan lied when he tempted Eve to sin, which thrust the world into destruction. He continues to lie today. He lied about God, creation, himself, and people. Since he is the ruler of this world, the world system is based on lies. World cultures often have perverted views on what is beautiful, ugly, righteous, evil, and successful. Since the system is based on lies, it leads people to destruction, including you and me, people of God.
And number five, the ruler of this world and God of this age. In John chapter 14, verse 30, Christ said, I will not speak with you much longer, for the ruler of this world is coming. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 19, John said, we know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. Likewise, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, Satan is called the ruler of this world, and the god of this age, or god of this world.
When Adam sinned in the garden, that made Satan the leader of this world and therefore of this age. Therefore, when Satan tempted Christ by offering him the nations of this world, it was a legitimate offer, people of God. He is currently over this world and age as the ruler of this world. Satan oversees a global system that is hostile to God and seeks to satisfy people apart from the truth of God, and is hostile to God's people. Lucifer might be the best translated as light bearer, day star, or morning star, which probably represents Satan's great glory before his fall, people of God.
Now, the ruler of the kingdom of the air. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, Paul calls Satan the ruler of the kingdom of the air. Also in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, Paul called the demons that Satan oversees the spiritual forces of evil in the heavens. Therefore, if God and the holy angels dwell in the third heaven, then Satan, being the ruler of the kingdom of the air and the one over the forces of evil in the heavens, must refer to this rule of the first and second heaven. The earthly atmosphere and space, which includes the stars and planets. Apparently, after Adam's original sin, Satan became the ruler of the earth. In John chapter 14, verse 30, which includes overseeing the first and second heaven.
Okay, people of God, you see, we're giving you the scriptures. This was intentional. Therefore, some demonic angels have ruling functions in the heavens and some on the earth today. He's called the tempter. Amen. And this is about him tempting Christ in the wilderness. Satan is a tempter by nature. He tempted Eve to eat the forbidden fruit in the garden. He tempted Christ to not obey God's will in the wilderness. He tempted Judas to deny Christ and to betray him, and Ananias to lie about the amount of money he gave from selling his land in Acts 5 and 3. He tempted husbands and wives to be unfaithful in marriage then and now. He tempts the people of nations to rebel against Christ. He is a tempter, people of God.
And Satan is an accuser. He accuses us before God. He accuses God to us and us to ourselves. This reminds us of Christ's role as our advocate. In the court of heaven, Satan attacks us, declaring how bad our sins are, and Christ defends us based on his righteous life and death for our sins. First John chapter 2, verse 1 says, "My little children, I am writing the thing to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. Christ is our advocate. He daily makes intercessions before God on our behalf." In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, "Because of this, there is no longer any condemnation for believers." Romans 8, 1.
Satan may accuse, but his words have no power in the heavenly courts against us. And this is because of Christ's payment for our sins and intercession on our behalf. Also, he's called the dragon, and this describes his ferociousness as he persecutes the followers of Jesus Christ. The serpent, he's called. This picture, Satan's guile and craftiness, as it refers to how Satan originally appeared in the garden as a serpent to trick Eve. Satan is always trying to trick and deceive people today. His temptations often come in ways that initially appear harmless, people of God.
Beelzebul was an ancient Philistine god who was originally called Beelzebub, which means the Lord of the Flies. Israel changed his name to Beelzebul to mock him, which means the Lord of Dunge, the ruler of demons. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 4 says, "Sometimes after the creation of the heavens and the earth, Satan led a rebellion against God in which one-third of the angels followed Satan and therefore were cast out of heaven. Satan continues to rule over them now."
That just simply means worthless or wickedness in the Word of God. That the enemy of your souls prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, be firm in your faith against his attacks, rooted, established, and immovable, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being experienced by your brothers and sisters throughout the earth. Lions attack sick, young, and straggling animals. They choose victims who are alone and not alert. Peter warns us to watch out for Satan when we are suffering or being persecuted. If you are feeling alone, weak, or helpless, and cut off from other believers, or if you are so focused on your troubles that you forget to watch for danger, those are times when you are especially vulnerable to Satan's attack, people of God.
The thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. That's John chapter 10, verse 10.
In contrast to the thief who takes life, Jesus gives life. The life he gives right now is abundantly rich and full. It is eternal, yet it begins immediately, people of God. Life in Christ is lived on a higher plane because of his overflowing forgiveness, love, and guidance. You know, people of God, have you taken God up on his offer about accepting Christ in your life to be reconciled back to God? This is important because the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy you. He came to destroy you. He wants you destroyed. He wants to destroy this earth because then Jesus won't come back and the rapture won't happen. He thinks he can interfere in God. That's how much of a delusion that he is under. Amen.
In Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 34, Paul describes the wonderful benefits of Christ's work on our behalf. "What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Indeed, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, freely give us all things. Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is the one who will condemn? Christ is the one who died, and more for than that he was raised. Who is at the right hand of God, and who also is interceding for us?
People of God, after this study today, I hope that we gave you scriptures and we tried to discuss and talk with you about what the word is saying about that. If you don't have the covering of the blood of Christ covering you, then you are open. You wide open to the enemy, to his power. You have no power against him without Christ. You can't stand up to the devil. He still is the God of God. But if you are a child of God, then you've been redeemed. And Jesus gave you back the title deed. And so no, you don't have no dominion over you. You have dominion over the enemy. That's how that works. But without Christ, the enemy, you are fair game. He hates you. And he knows that's the only way to get back at God, but is to get to you. And we need to keep ourselves covered, people of God. That's what God is telling us about the enemy. He showed us all the things that he come to do, what he was created for. He came out of pure evil that was within itself, and it did all this. It was the fall of mankind. And still today, people trying to act like the enemy ain't real and blaming other things. Mental health. If you don't know Jesus, the enemy can jump on you and you go shoot up anybody he wants you to. If you don't know Jesus, then when they be doing the rituals on TV and they're doing them anyway, whether we see them or not, they affect us. But if you are a believer in Christ and covered in the blood, it can't come near you. The enemy knows that he can't touch you. He just make you think he can. By putting little obstacles in your way, doing little things for a moment that he had to go before God, walking to and fro, and he had to ask to do it. He was created by God. He said, I am he who made the blacksmith, who forges weapons, fiery weapons. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. People of God, remember, every time we do something that displays the devil's characteristics, we have allowed the enemy in our house. And once he is in, he will wreak havoc. Amen. That's why we see on a daily, on television, how someone picked up a gun to kill others, using climate control weather machines, and saying it's the climate control, but they're using weather machines, cloud making machines, making trails and pouring stuff on us that we know nothing about. What is really going on? But this world is under the control of the enemy. People have sold their birthright for money and fame and to be a celebrity. We cannot allow the enemy to just take over. We have children and grandchildren to think about. Our genealogy, what our destiny is on this earth, what we're supposed to do. And the one thing I know that we all can do is pray. Pray against the enemy. Pray against everything he stands for. Pray against every time you see him doing something on the earth and you recognize his fruits operator and not the Holy Spirit. Recognize when you do something wrong and sin is trying to enter in your life. The enemy's trying to get in to wreak havoc on you. Sickness. Death. That's what he comes with, people of God. So we have to just take our rightful place. Know who you are during these times. It's going to get rougher than this. We're going to see things that we never thought we would see before. The enemy manifests himself. He used to be in the closet. He used to hide, not a Ouija board. I seen one, they done made a big one and people playing in it like it's a game. These demons, these witches, these warlocks, they ain't playing no game with you. Some of y'all think that the devil ain't real. Amen. People of God, I hope that this study has given you some clarity to who the enemy is, but that God created him and he is in control of him. And we don't have to fear him, but we have to know who he is. And we have to ask for discernment to see him when he's slivering in and being crafty and deceitful. Only sometimes we'll see things that are not true. With our own eyes, the enemy will deceive us, so we need to ask for truth from the Holy Spirit. Things don't look right, ask for truth about it. Holy Spirit, let me see truth. And then it will happen. People of God, I just want to go on to say, if you don't know Christ, the devil has control over your life. And God wants to set you free. That's what's happening. If you're looking at this and God has got your attention, that means that he's trying to save you. Doesn't matter what you've done now. Christ died for this. And where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more, people of God. So stand up. Don't be defeated by the enemy. And please don't choose money in this temporal world. You could choose money and seal a deal with the devil and drop dead right then. That's his purpose for you. He don't have nothing good for you but to use you, because he cannot operate without a body, an animal, or a house. And don't you allow your body to be a resting place for demons. When you take Satan's bait to come and become an agent of Satan or a worker and coming up against God, you become an agent of Satan for his cause and a worker for his kingdom, a slave. Demons need a body, people of God. Don't let it be yours. Remember, he's going around like a roaring lion, seeking, looking all in your house, going around you, trying to see if any sin in your life so you can get an opening. Remember, don't let the devil lodge and operate in your life. Don't let him live inside of you. Amen. Denounce everything unlike God in your life. Get free from the enemy. And then tell somebody else about Jesus so they can be free. There is a devil, people of God, and he is real. And these things you see, even the weather. Don't you know these demon worshipers be worshiping and cursing God and all that kind of stuff, and calling down, you know, calling down different elements on us? He still has to ask for permission though. Hey, he ain't running nothing. God is running. God is in control. Amen. Remember that. The benediction, people of God. Glory to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26.
Enjoy the rest of your week. God bless you. Love you.